Hello. Okay. Now, so where was I? Oh yes. Apa kabar and kumusta po kayo? Kumusta from Spanish. Yeah. So we'll talk about the history of Southeast Asia and the languages in the region. Right. So, does anybody know what this is? A statue. Right. It's a carving from New Zealand. That's from Madagascar. That's from Indonesia, and that's also from the far east of Indonesia. And has anybody, okay, who speaks Indonesian or is currently learning Indonesian? Show of hands. Satu dua. Dua tiga. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay. Filipino, Tagalog, no. Polynesian languages, yes, there we go. Right, so the reason why I ask is because as a native speaker of Malay, okay, I was on a trip to New Zealand and it really became, the trip to New Zealand is really about blood-sucking insects and hello. Yeah, so while I was on a road trip round from North Island all the way down to Christchurch, actually, I met some locals and we were just talking about languages and things like that. You know, that's what we polyglots do. This was in ancient times when I was 19, a long time ago. So anyway, what happened was we were talking about bed bugs. And I asked him, how do you say bed bugs in Maori? And he was like, not too sure, but the word for lice is kutu, which is almost the same as in Indonesian. In fact, it's the same word. So the fact is, New Zealand is one of the southernmost outposts. It is the southernmost outpost of the Austronesian languages. You're people who came from Southeast Asia about 1,000 years ago, maybe more, and settled in Aotearoa, which is New Zealand. And in fact, the name New Zealand is an European, you know, name. Before that, there were many names, and one of them for the northern part of the island was Te Ika Amawi. And Ika, what is ikan in Indonesian? Fish, exactly. So it means Maui's fish in Maori. It's the same word, Ika, ikan. And that's the northern part of the island. And the southern part is called Te Waka Amawi. And in parts of the Philippines, there's a type of boat called a banka. Waka, the same word. It's exactly the same word. And the word for hello, when I finally learned Maori, was ke ora. And the word, the kia or kia, is beginning, is a way to say, let it be, may you be. It's used in the subjunctive and how to make it for greetings. And the word ora means life, health, vitality. May you be healthy, may you be alive, may you live well. Okay? The thing is, Indonesians, Filipinos use the word ora all the bloody time. We just don't know it. You know what? Example. Ora and ola in Hawaiian, meaning life, it comes from the very, very ancient word wada. Wada, to be, to exist, you know, to have. It also means wealth. And this word was obviously spoken, was used by people who lived in probably Taiwan or the south of China, probably 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. And in Malay, we have ada, Indonesian, ada. To have and exist is the same word, ada. Ada, ada. Ada in Ilocano, to have, to exist, to own. Which is the Ilocano, by the way, is one of the languages of the northern Philippines. And if you move south a little bit to the central Philippines, wala, well, the northern part, the central part of the North Island, Luzon, wala, meaning not to exist. So if you ask a Filipino, do you have it? Wala, I don't have it. So it's the same word. Although it became the negative, it took on the suffix, the made it negative. And this word is also used in Java. Ora, meaning no, in Javanese, the same word. And this is and also the word for louse or lice, flea, is kutu in Maori, in Malay, Indonesian, on top it is kutu. And you have kutu, kutu, utu, utu, and uku in Hawaiian. And of course, I'm sure you've played. This is a louse, yes. Looks familiar. The same one. This is the ukulele. And does anybody know what ukulele means? Yes, jump. Somebody say jump, correct. Jumping flea. Jumping flea. Uku for louse or flea. Lele means to jump, to fly, to move through the air. Lele. And what animal moves through the air? A fly. Lele or rere in Polynesian languages, meaning to fly, to jump, to leap, is a relative of the Malay Indonesian word lalat, which is word for fly. Fly isn't here, so fly and fly. It's not only in English we have this Interesting. So why is this happening? Why do words, you know, languages so far away have very similar words? Coincidence? Of course not. This is the reason why. So you've got a very big, this group of languages, basically from Taiwan included, all the way to the east coast of Africa, right across the Indian Ocean, Indonesia, Malaysia, the whole of Borneo, all the way across, skirting Papua New Guinea, Australia is not included, all the way across Polynesia to Easter Island, which is very close to South America, quite close to South America, belongs to one single family of languages. And before Europeans, before Christopher Columbus, and before the Vikings started going to Greenland, this was the most widespread family of languages in the world. Basically, what, half the globe, three quarters of the world was colonized by people who speak these languages, you know? And yes, so these languages were called the Austronesian, the Southern Islands languages. Spoken by 386 million people, and it's the fifth largest family, you know, language family in the world by number of speakers, behind Indo-European, and of course, our Sino-Tibetan, and Niger-Congo, and Afro-Asiatic. And major languages are Malay, Indonesian, including Indonesian and Malay, Javanese, Filipino, and about 1,257 other languages. Yes, it's a huge, yeah, it's the second most of any in the world. People don't know this. You think Indo-European is huge? This is, I think this can give you a fight. You guys are fighting, I'm kidding. Speakers of language. So let's look at where they're spoken and the migration. So the predominant, the theory that's most commonly accepted now is that if you see the very top, the island of Taiwan, this is where the language has the most variation. If you look at the different branches of the language, the most ancient divisions are found in Taiwan, as of, you know, as of now. And then they spread gradually to the Philippines and further down to Indonesia and west from Borneo. Here, a certain group actually went all the way to Africa, to Madagascar, where people who speak Malagasy live today. And another group went east across Micronesia, Melanesia, all the way up into Polynesia, New Zealand, and the far end, Easter Island, and the far north, it's Hawaii, all the way there, yeah. Same group of people. Of course, most of these regions, especially in Southeast Asia, were already inhabited. So the Austronesian speakers who went there probably encountered local people, intermarried with them, exchanged, had a cultural exchange, they borrowed words, and this caused, you know, the various languages to evolve. Yes, but there was a lot of linguistic variation before, and now it still continues. And if we go on to the next slide, sorry. This is an example, it's a very bad photograph. I took this in Oxford. This is one of the, a type of craft that was probably used to go across the oceans, to circumnavigate, not circumnavigate, but to go across probably the Pacific, actually. And it's got a double hull, you know, and it's got living space where you can put your chickens and pigs and everything. Families, you know, husbands, wives, killed children, they all, you know, go on top. Yeah, that's as if chickens and pigs are more important than, you know. But anyway, families move and they travel for weeks, probably months, in the ocean on places like this, on boats like this, to far off places. And so the Austronesian languages, if you look at the family tree, all right, there are actually about 10 branches, as far as I know. 9 of them are found on Taiwan, in Taiwan, where they are spoken by, what, 3% of the population. So China, Taiwan, before it became Chinese, was Austronesian speaking. And you have 9 branches in Taiwan, and only one group decided to leave and conquer everything else, settle everywhere. So all the Philippine languages in Borneo, Indonesia, this is the part of Indonesia that's close to Papua New Guinea, and then the famous South Pacific, the Pacific Islands. And Borneo, there's one group of people in Borneo that decided to go to Africa, you know, and that's what happens. So all these languages, most of these languages are still spoken in Taiwan today, you know, so I don't speak them, so I can't say, you know, how similar they are, but we can see from some of the words that we can share. Okay, here we go. So Indonesian, it's under Malay here, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Words like these are used throughout the Pacific. If you look at Tagalog, isa, dalawa, tatlo, apat, lima. You know, Malay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This row, Fijian, dua, rua, tolu, va, lima. It's very similar. all the way to Maori, Hawaiian, you know, Maori is Tahi, Rua, Toru, Fa, Rima. The words are very similar. The numbers especially, very, very common vocabulary, the body parts, they're all very similar across this huge region. In Africa, in Malagash, I don't speak Malagash, I'm just, you know, pretending to, you know, Rua. I don't speak Malagash. So Rua, Telu, Efat, and Jimi. Okay, so major languages, we saw those languages, all that. So these are, the one that is probably most famous would be Indonesian and Malay. 300 million speakers, you know, native and second language. Spoken generally Malay Peninsula, Sumatra, and coastal Borneo. But it's, of course, spoken throughout Indonesia as an official language, all the way up to Brunei, the whole of Malaysia. People say it's one of the easiest languages to learn. I will say no, and this is why. So it's got an SVO structure, subject, verb, object, like many European languages. Okay, good for you. The roots are bisyllabic, so it consists of two syllables, like buka, tutup, pukul, ayam, ikan, mata, hari. These words are all matahari. Yeah, that's a famous one. Yeah, who? And in fact, I think matahari used to live in Indonesia. That's why she took the name. It means the eye of dawn, the eye of the sun, the eye of dawn, the day, sorry. And it's the word for sun. And it's mildly agglutinative. We use prefixes, suffixes, infixes, and circumfixes. We'll see how it goes with this. And reduplication. In fact, these features are found in all the languages in varying degrees. So some of them have more, some have less. Malay Indonesian is somewhere in the middle. Okay, so gigi means tooth, two syllables. Gerigi, if you put the ER between the first and the second letter, means a saw, like many, many, many little teeth. That's what it means, saw. Ajar is to teach. Ajaran is teaching. Belajar is to learn. Mengajar is to teach someone, like I'm teaching you now. Mengajar-ajar is to teach all around, to teach very different things in different places. Belajar is a student. Belajaran is a lesson. Berbelajaran is educated, okay? So yes, there's no conjugation, there's no complex case system, there are no irregular verbs, but you know, this is probably the most complex amount of, inflection you would find in Malay Indonesian, all right? So next group. So, an example, jalan, meaning road, path. It's jalan-jalan, meaning roads, paths, plural. So you make a plural by doubling the word, any word. You can make it double. So, yeah, so a book is a buku. Books are buku-buku. Kertas is paper, all right? You might recognize it from Swahili karatasi, which is probably from the same etymology. Kertas, kertas. Berjalan is to walk. Berjalan-jalan is to walk around. Menjalankan is to operate or to run, to execute. It's a causative verb. Dijalankan is the passive of to be operated on or to be made to run, to be made to execute. Menjalani, to walk on, to go through, to undergo. Dijalani, the thing that's walked on, the thing that's undergone, endured. Yes, okay, shall I go on? No, I'm kidding, don't worry. The list goes on, but you know, I'm just simplifying things. Perjalanan is a journey, like the journey we're having, you know, our polyglot journey would be perjalanan polyglot. Yes. Perjalanan, berperjalanan, the one who has a long journey. Okay, and we go, so you see the prefixes, they come in front. These are prefixes, these are suffixes. A circumfix is in front and behind, and there are no infixes in this word, but you know, they exist to some extent. All right, so Malay Indonesian, anybody still wants to learn it? Okay, good, fine. Ooh, okay, great. Other facts, standard Malay has several names depending on where you are. This is a political issue, so I won't go too deep into it. It's the official language of Malaysia, Brunei, Indonesia, and one of the co-official languages of Singapore. In 1945, after the Dutch decided to give Indonesia, to allow Indonesians to be free, they decided to make a minority language their official language, Malay. See, the vast majority of Indonesians spoke Javanese, which is a related language. It's about as close to Malay as English and German or something, Slovak and Russian, or probably. So there is some degree of intelligibility, but it's not, you know, it has to be learned as a new language. But the Javanese people, despite being the majority, decided to pick Malay as their national language, you know, because Malay at that time was already a lingua franca in Southeast Asia. People spoke Malay in trade, in business, So at that time, even though it was only spoken by 5% of the population of Indonesia at that time, so it became the official language. And the Malay-Indonesian language has a large amount of loan words from Sanskrit. You know, the oldest writings were written in Indian script. And this is why. The reason why is because the region of Southeast Asia, the Straits of Malacca, were traditionally a crossroads for different cultures. People from India would go to China, and they'll pass through Singapore, the Straits of Malacca between Malaysia and Sumatra, Indonesia, all the way to China, and vice versa. Chinese merchants would pass the other way. The culture would later come under heavy Islamic influence, you know, from Indian subcontinent and from the Middle East. And you have Arabic words, the abakabar, the khabar, from Arabic and from Persian words, a bit of Persian as well. All right, that's clear. That's it. And now Tagalog, people don't ask. So it's the standardized form of the standardized form is called Filipino. Okay, but most Filipinos call it Tagalog, and it comes from Tagalog, which is the people of the river people, because that's where the riverine areas were where it was traditionally spoken. And it was, of course, a lot of Spanish loanwords because of the history. And it has, differently from Malay Indonesian, it has a VS, verb, object, subject, or verb, subject, object, word order. The verb comes first. All right. And as you will see, this word order is very, very common in Austronesian languages. I think it was the original word order that came from Taiwan and South China, you know, but it got changed. Malay sort of decided to follow an SVO word order for whatever reason. We know European languages. This is my favorite part. So European languages have, most of them have a subject, nominative, object, accusative structure, nominative, accusative, except Basque, which has ergative, absolutive. There are actually only two types of general syntactic alignments, and there is these two types and there is this one. It's so unique that it has its own name, the Philippine or Austronesian type voice system. I prefer Austronesian. What happens is there's no such thing as an active or passive form. Every verb is marked for the most important actor in the sentence. So, for example, the woman gave a present to a neighbor. In your conversation, who is more important, the woman, the present, or the neighbor? It's up to you to decide. Once you've decided that, you have to pick the verb that agrees with whatever it is. If it's a woman, nagbigay means the past tense, the woman gave something, is the most important one. And so, ang babae, which means woman. So you see these little words in front, ang, nang, sa, they're the equivalent of case markers in European languages, Indo-European languages, but they come in front. So ang babae is nominative, ang, nang, regalo, you know, from Spanish, present, sa kapit bahay, which means to the neighbor, kapit bahay. And if you want to say that a woman gave the present to a neighbor, the present then becomes nominative and the verb changes to show that the object is being emphasized. So ibinigay ng babae ang regalo sa kapit bahay. And if you want to emphasize the place, the direction it was given, she gave the present to the neighbor, then you say, binigyan ng babae ng regalo ang kapitbahay. So the verb changes and also the cases change depending on which is the most important actor, you know, receiver or location. And this is only like the three of them. There are like five or six different others. So this is this type of structure. Yeah, that is, it's neither nominative, accusative. No, it doesn't follow that pattern at all. And I think this was the original system that sort of broke down later on in Malay. It's become simplified in Indonesian. But yeah, okay. And then this is only the tip of the iceberg. Each of these verbs can inflect for past tense, present, future, you know, subjunctive, whatever. Example, and you will see the same patterns, repetition and reduplication. Nagbigay is gave, nagbibigay is giving, magbibigay will give. So the suffix, the prefix changes, and also there's repetition of certain syllables, depending on which word it is. Ibinigay, ibinibigay, ibibigay, you know, and so on. And so forth, and you get like hundreds of different combinations, all right. And adjectives can be have singulars and plural forms. So you repeat one of the syllables: maganda, beautiful; magaganda, they are beautiful; matalino, matatalino, you know; mataba, matataba, and so on and so forth. So you repeat a lot of syllables, and this is very common throughout the whole family. Repetition, repeat, reduplication. It's very, very common. Sorry. In the Philippines, yes, it is. Yes. And then we go to Malagash, which is originally, which originates from the south of Borneo, believe it or not. I have no idea how they made it there or why, but they landed in Madagascar. The ancestors intermarried with African people, and their language is now the dominant language, the only native language in Madagascar, in fact. So it's the different dialects, you know, but they're all Austronesian, and they all have a verb's initial structure. The verb is always first, and it's the same thing like you saw in the Philippine languages. The verb changes depending on which actor or which element in the sentence you want to emphasize. So I am washing my hands, you know, my hands are being washed by me. I'm using soap to wash my hands, even though these sentences would be about the same in English. Change of word order here and there a little bit, but in the verb actually changes. And the pronouns change as well. In this case, I am washing. In this case, au becomes part of the verb. Part of the verb. So it changes. It's actually pretty complicated. I don't speak Malagasy, but knowing a language like Tagalog, you can actually figure out pretty much what it means. That's how close they are. I mean, the grammar. That's how similar they are. All right. So we've looked at Malay. We've looked at Malagasy. Let's go a little bit further east. Samoan. So Samoan, the same with Tagalog has singular and plural forms. So you repeat part of the words. So atamai is clever, atamamai is clever, you're clever when you're referring to many, many people. Emo, which is to blink, and emo is to blink many, many times. Right. Alofa is to love, and alolofa means to love many people. And it's the same word as in aloha in Hawaiian. To love, it's the same word. In Maori is aroha, the same thing. All right. Manava, manana, manavanava, yeah. And so the structure is like this. Yes. It's a little bit simplified. You have ua, which is the past tense. Mawa is to catch. By the policeman, lengawi, ngawi, ngawi, the thief. So this Polynesian has evolved into more of an ergative type structure. So the actor always has eh in front of it. You know, this one, rather than okay. And when we were talking about a few days before the talk, I sent a message. Is it? Can you guess which language is this on the Polyglots group? Anybody has a clue? Oh, have you already read my reply? No. Guess. No. It looks Indonesian, but it isn't. No. It's one language. Where would this be spoken? Considering how. No. It's too close to Indonesian to be Maori. Malayu? No. Related to it. Close-ish. Close-ish. Yeah. No. Nobody. No. No, it's spoken in Thailand. Yeah, on the Andaman Sea. So if you have a map of Thailand, I could go back a little bit, show you. In the map of Thailand, you've got the, oof, goodness, I hate that. The map of Thailand, this one. So very briefly. So you see this area, the Straits of Malacca, and there are these little islands between Thailand and Myanmar, these little islands here. That's where they're spoken. And they're related, and they're not Thai or Burmese. They are related to Malay, the languages that they speak there. So this is one of them, and it's called Urak Lawai, and Urak means orang in Malay. Lawai is loud. It's the sea people, the sea gypsies. Yeah, the sea gypsies who live there, and it's actually a Malay. It's very close to Malay. If you speak Indonesian and Malay, it's pretty much similar. Okay, I think yeah. All right. So that's the name of the language. All right. So you recognize certain words like nasi ini, this is ini. Nyaman has a different meaning in Malay, but it's pretty close, you know. Nanak is close to anak, which means child, you know, things like that. Surai is surat, you know, Malay. Berai is berat, you know, something like that. So, okay, right, I think half an hour, yep, about almost there. Yep, that's it. All right, so any questions? Thank you. Sunday, I don't want to, you know, give you too overload you with too much information on Sunday afternoon. Yeah. Okay, so any questions? Or shall we read the slide of this? Or is it not? Oh, perfect. What's the current hypothesis among linguists on the Japanese has an Austronesian substrate? Who asked me that? Okay. The question is, does Japanese have an Austronesian substrate? Is it related to Austronesian languages? I personally think so. No, don't shoot me, but I think so. I think that a long time ago, maybe some Austronesian people actually sailed north, because from Taiwan and the south of China, the coast to go up to Japan is not really far away. It's not difficult. There is a lot of influence from languages like Korean and beyond that, Mongolian and all that, because the structure is very similar to Turkic Mongol languages, but the vocabulary, there's some core vocabulary that's very similar, very, very similar to Malay. That's very, like the word for eye in Japanese is me, hand is te, Malay mata, tangan, you know, very close. The word for fire is he, but it was already something like pi or something fi, api. I don't know whether it's the same, but it looks suspiciously similar, you know, very basic vocabulary, but who knows, maybe. All right, so any questions? Maybe, oh, there's more. Oh, more coming in, sorry, okay. Can you comment on the difference between Tagalog and Filipino? Yes, Tagalog is the language of an ethnic group. Filipino has been standardized, so it's actually Tagalog that has been, with all the dialect features, you know, that's been removed. And there are some of the words they use in Tagalog are not used in Filipino. Those have been borrowed from neighboring languages to make it more neutral. But 99.999% of it is pretty much the same. I think it's the same. I feel it's the same. Anyway. I could be wrong, but you know, yeah. Thank you. What do you think about the idea about Austro-Thai? Oh goodness, who is asking me all these? Okay, so what do you think about Austro-Thai relating Austronesian to Thai Kada languages like Thai? Okay, so Andre, oh, thank you. Is Malay related to Thai? Yes, I think so. I think so. There are a lot of words that are very similar. I don't want to go into that, even though they are very different languages. You know, but there are, yeah, I see some resemblances. Yeah, that's all I'll talk about. Thanks. And any questions? Okay, thank you. Can we ask? I'm terrified. I'm terrified of using the microphone. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Yep. Okay. So if a person were really, really fluent in English, how much Russian would he understand? It's about that different. Yeah, about that same difference. So you might note, you might recognize a few words here and there, but otherwise, nah, nothing. Yeah, it's gone. Yes. Okay. The answer is no. They're not related. They've been there for much longer. Okay. Some people say they might be related to languages in Papua New Guinea. Maybe again, that's very, very putative. It's not accepted, but no, they're not related to them. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yes. About the okay, does Malay in Malaysia have fewer Sanskrit influence than Indonesian? Okay, I would say no, they have the same amount of influence. The only difference is the Malay in Malaysia has been influenced by English more, and Indonesia by Dutch. Those are the main differences. And I think Malay now uses more Arabic words than Indonesian, slightly more, but it's not much. Yeah, so no, I don't think it's there's any difference. Yeah, any other questions? Yes. Of course. Okay, so Malay was written in Arabic script until the late 19th, early 20th century. Javanese, I think, is still being used by mostly older people, but people who have very, very ceremonial roles, they still use the Javanese script, which is derived from Sanskrit, or, you know, from Brahmic script. The Philippines, I think there are a couple of scripts that are still in use that come from the same South Indian influence. They all come from India. The ones in Southeast Asia, all the writing systems are borrowed from the Indian languages in one form or another. Yes, yeah, that's it. Oh, sorry. I can read it, thank you. Samoan seems to have very few sounds, mostly vowels. Is this typical of Austronesian languages? Yes. Yes. The Austronesian languages do not like a lot of consonant sounds, a lot of vowel sounds. Only five vowels, which is why Malay people often say things like, what do they say? I don't think of a word. The Malay word for a motorcycle is motosikal. Vowel, a consonant vowel, consonant vowel, consonant vowel. It's like that, you know? So yeah, I think that's why. The whole family is like this. Yeah. Okay, any other questions? Yes, of course.
Well, maybe that's not entirely true for the whole family. Like, I've read about languages of Vanuatu and New Caledonia, and some of them really have a crazy amount of vowels.
Yes, the further you go to the Pacific area, like Micronesia, and further down a little bit to New Caledonia, those have even developed more vowels than normal. Like, they started, they have U and all that stuff coming in. Yeah. Yeah, we seem to love vowels for some reason. I have no idea why. Yeah, but it's also the culture, because a lot of people are fishermen. I guess when you're fishing and calling someone from the sea, it's harder to, you know, to say shprt than pa ba, you know. Vowel sounds are, you hear them louder. Maybe that's why. You know, because you see they live in the ocean, so maybe that's why they prefer, you know, it's easier to listen to. That's why. Maybe. That's it. Okay. Any other questions? Yes. Can you repeat that? Sorry. Okay, so how many? Yeah. Very small. Apparently, most of them are endangered. Young kids are speaking Mandarin now. Even when I went to Taiwan last year, in the countryside, most children speak Mandarin. Yeah, it's very sad. It's only the elders who speak these languages. Yeah. Oh, it's coming in. Okay. All right. Any cool insights on some of the Formosan languages? I don't have any personal experience learning any of them, but I do know that they tend to be very, very complex, have complex grammatical structures, some like the Filipino languages, more of it. They're not like Malay, and they are verb initial. They put a verb in front. So that is quite common throughout, yeah. Anything else? No. Okay, I think. Nobody? Okay, good. No questions? Okay, thank you. It's a Sunday afternoon. I want to have some tea as well. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Yeah. Okay, no questions. Thank you. All right. Thanks. Bye.